Dreamscape presents Uncle Tom's Cabin by Harriet Beecher Stowe. Narrated by Susie Berneis. Uncle Tom's Cabin, or Life Among the Lowly. Volume 1. Chapter 1, in which the listener is introduced to a man of humanity. Late in the afternoon of a chilly day in February, two gentlemen were sitting alone over their wine in a well-furnished dining parlor in the town of P in Kentucky. There were no servants present, and the gentlemen, with chairs closely approaching, seemed to be discussing some subject with great earnestness. For convenience sake, we have said hitherto two gentlemen. One of the parties, however, when critically examined, did not seem, strictly speaking, to come under the species. He was a short, thick-set man with coarse, commonplace features and that swaggering air of pretension which marks a low man who is trying to elbow his way upward in the world. He was much overdressed, in a gaudy vest of many colors, a blue neckerchief bedropped gaily with yellow spots and arranged with a flaunting tie, quite in keeping with the general air of the man. His hands, large and coarse, were plentifully bedecked with rings, and he wore a heavy gold watch chain with a bundle of seals of portentous size and a great variety of colors attached to it, which, in the ardor of conversation, he was in the habit of flourishing and jingling with evident satisfaction. His conversation was in free and easy defiance of Murray's grammar, and was garnished at convenient intervals with various profane expressions, which not even the desire to be graphic in our account shall induce us to transcribe. His companion, Mr. Shelby, had the appearance of a gentleman, and the arrangements of the house and the general air of the housekeeping indicated easy and even opulent circumstances. As we before stated, the two were in the midst of an earnest conversation.
"That is the way I should arrange the matter," said Mr. Shelby. "I can't make trade that way. I positively can't, Mr. Shelby," said the other, holding up a glass of wine between his eye and the light.
"Why, the fact is, Haley, Tom is an uncommon fellow. He is certainly worth that sum anywhere. Steady, honest, capable, manages my whole farm like a clock."
"You mean honest as niggers go," said Haley, helping himself to a glass of brandy.
"No, I mean really. Tom is a good, steady, sensible, pious fellow. He got religion at a camp meeting 4 years ago, and I believe he really did get it. I've trusted him since then with everything I have. Money, house, horses, and let him come and go around the country, and I always found him true and square in everything."
"Some folks don't believe there is pious niggers, Shelby," said Haley, with a candid flourish of his hand. "But I do. I had a fella now, and this year last lot I took to Orleans. 'Twas as good as a meetin' now, really, to hear that critter pray. And he was quite gentle and quiet-like. He fetched me a good sum, too, for I bought him cheap of a man that was obliged to sell out, so I realized 600 on him. Yes, I consider religion a valuable thing in a nigger when it's a genuine article and no mistake."
"Well, Tom's got the real article, if ever a fellow had," rejoined the other. "Why, last fall I let him go to Cincinnati alone to do business for me, and bring home $500. Tom, says I to him, I trust you, because I think you're a Christian. I know you wouldn't cheat." "Tom comes back, sure enough. I knew he would. Some low fellas, they say, said to him, 'Tom, why don't you make tracks for Canada?'
Ah, Massa trusted me, and I couldn't.
They told me about it. I am sorry to part with Tom, I must say. You ought to let him cover the whole balance of the debt, and you would, Haley, if you had any conscience."
"Well, I've got just as much conscience as any man in business can afford to keep. Just a little, you know, to swear by, as 'twere," said the trader, jocularly. "And then I'm ready to do anything in reason to oblige friends. But this year, you see, is a leetle too hard on a fella. A leetle too hard."
The trader sighed contemplatively and poured out some more brandy.
"Well, then, Haley, how will you trade?" said Mr. Shelby,
after an uneasy interval of silence.
Well, haven't you a boy or gal that you could throw in with Tom?
None that I could well spare, to tell the truth. It's only hard necessity makes me willing to sell it all. I don't like parting with any of my hands, that's a fact.
Here the door opened, and a small quadroon boy between 4 and 5 years of age entered the room. There was something in his appearance remarkably beautiful and engaging. His black hair, fine as floss silk, hung in glossy curls about his round, dimpled face, while a pair of large, dark eyes, full of fire and softness, looked out from beneath the rich, long lashes as he peered curiously into the apartment. A gay robe of scarlet and yellow plaid, carefully made and neatly fitted, set off to advantage the dark and rich style of his beauty, and a certain comic air of assurance, blended with bashfulness, showed that he had been not unused to being petted and noticed by his master.
"Hello, Jim Crow," said Mr. Shelby, whistling,
and snapping a bunch of raisins towards him.
"Pick that up now."
The child scampered with all his little strength after the prize, while his master laughed.
"Come here, Jim Crow," said he.
The child came up, and the master patted the curly head and chucked him under the chin.
"Now, Jim, show this gentleman how you can dance and sing."
The boy commenced one of those wild, grotesque songs common among the Negroes, in a rich, clear voice, accompanying his singing with many comic evolutions of the hands, feet, and whole body, all in perfect time to the music.
"Bravo," said Haley, throwing him a quarter of an orange.
"Now, Jim, walk like old Uncle Cudjo when he has the rheumatism," said his master.
Instantly, the flexible limbs of the child assumed the appearance of deformity and distortion as, with his back humped up and his master's stick in his hand, he hobbled about the room, his childish face drawn into a doleful pucker, and spitting from right to left in imitation of an old man. Both gentlemen laughed uproariously.
"Now, Jim,"
said his master,
"show us how old Elder Robbins leads the psalm."
The boy drew his chubby face down to a formidable length and commenced toning a psalm tune through his nose with imperturbable gravity.
"Hurrah! Bravo! What a young'un!" said Haley. "That chap's a case, I'll promise." "Tell you what," said he, suddenly clapping his hand on Mr. Shelby's shoulder. "Fling in that chap and I'll settle the business, I will. Come now, if that ain't doing the thing up about the rightest."
At this moment, the door was pushed gently open, and a young quadroon woman, apparently about 25, entered the room. There needed only a glance from the child to her to identify her as its mother. There was the same rich, full, dark eye with its long lashes, the same ripples of silky black hair. The brown of her complexion gave way on the cheek to a perceptible flush, which deepened as she saw the gaze of the strange man fixed upon her in bold and undisguised admiration. Her dress was of the neatest possible fit and set off to advantage her finely molded shape. A delicately formed hand and a trim foot and ankle were items of appearance that did not escape the quick eye of the trader, well used to run up at a glance the points of a fine female article.
"Well, Eliza?"
said her master, as she stopped and looked hesitatingly at him.
"I was looking for Harry, please, sir."
And the boy bounded toward her, showing his spoils, which he had gathered in the skirt of his robe.
"Well, take him away, then," said Mr. Shelby,
and hastily she withdrew, carrying the child on her arm.
"By Jupiter,"
said the trader, turning to him in admiration.
"There's an article now. You might make your fortune on that air gal in Orleans any day. I've seen over 1,000 in my day paid down for gals not a bit handsomer."
"I don't want to make my fortune on her," said Mr. Shelby dryly,
and seeking to turn the conversation, he uncorked a bottle of fresh wine and asked his companion's opinion of it.
"Capital, sir, first chop," said the trader.
Then turning and slapping his hand familiarly on Shelby's shoulder, he added,
"Come, how will you trade about the gal? What shall I say for her? What'll you take?"
"Mr. Haley, she is not to be sold," said Shelby. "My wife would not part with her for her weight in gold."
"Aye, women always say such things, 'cause they ain't no sort of calculation. Just show him how many watches, feathers, and trinkets one's weight in gold would buy. And that alters the case, I reckon.
I tell you, Haley, this must not be spoken of. I say no, and I mean no, said Shelby, decidedly.
Well, you'll let me have the boy, though, said the trader. You must own I've come down pretty handsomely for him.
What on earth can you want with the child? Said Shelby.
Why, I've got a friend that's going into this year branch of the business. Wants to buy up handsome boys to raise for the market. Fancy articles entirely.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.